Hi, I'm Keith with Danfoss Food Retail Controls, and today's video will be on the wiring for both power and communications to the 750 case control.
Thanks, Keith. On this video, we will cover the power, communication, and I/O wiring of the AK-CC 750. We'll start with the power wiring, which comes into the top left of the case controller. We're going to need 24 volts AC or DC coming into the case controller to power it up. As you'll see, you have three terminals here for positive, negative, and a ground terminal. Any Danfoss AdaptCool power supply can be used here and supply sufficient power to the unit, even if we do have to attach an additional extension module onto the end of the 750's baseboard. From there, we'll move into the middle of the case controller where we have our communication wiring. This is also a three-terminal plug. Here we have labels of A, B, and shield. And with this being echelon communication on the 750, one of the nice things there is that it's not polarity sensitive. So your A and B terminals can be reversed from device to device on the network and not have any negative effects. Cable type being used needs to match Danfoss specs. So if we are using the echelon TP78 version of the case controller, then we need to make sure we're using a level 4 cable. And if we are using the echelon RS485 version of the case controller, we need to make sure that we are using an EIA 485 rated cable. You'll see one of two scenarios in the case controller's communication plug. You should either see one or two cables landed on each terminal. If it's just a single cable, that would identify the case controller as being at the end of the communication network. And along with the cable, you should see an end-of-line resistor, 120 ohms, in parallel with the A and B terminals. The second scenario you might see is two cables coming into the communication plug. If you see that, that means that it's somewhere in the middle of the loop. There should be no end-of-line resistor along with the two cables landed on the plug. Anything beyond that, in terms of number of cables landed on that one plug, is going to be something that doesn't follow a point-to-point daisy chain. So you'll want to make sure that you're correcting that to get it down to one of these two situations. Along the top of the controller is where we're going to have our analog inputs. So you have 11 inputs here. The wiring can be for our temperature sensors in the case, our pressure transducer on the suction line, or our dry contact digital inputs. Temp sensor is going to be an AKS-11 or PT-1000 style of sensor. Signal and ground terminals for each input, so with the sensor not being polarity sensitive, you can land either lead of the sensor onto either terminal of the input. Dry contact digitals would follow the same pattern as far as just landing on a signal and ground. And then we have our pressure transducer, which is going to be a three-wire connection. We have a 5-volt supply we have to send to the transducer. If you look at the top of the case controller's labeling on the cover, you'll see the 5-volt terminal there. And then you'll have a signal and ground terminal coming back from the transducer that gives us our voltage range of 0.5 volt to 4.5 volts corresponding to the pressure we're reading. Transducer type being used needs to be an AKS-32R. If this is an HFC application, that gives us the ratio metric output we need. Or if it's a CO2 application, we would need to use an AKS-2050 for the same reasons. Inputs are not predefined in terms of which sensors or which transducer needs to be landed where. So this is something you would define in the configuration of the case controller with the quick setup. Along the bottom of the case controller, we have our 8 relays. So 4 solid state relays for electronic expansion valve. This is not going to be an output that automatically has a voltage coming out of it when the case controller is powered up. So this is something where you will need to externally feed voltage that matches the expansion valve's coil through one side of the solid state relay. So we would typically have a 24 volt, 115 volt, or 230 volt coil. With that power, again, passing through one side of the solid-state relay. Our additional 4 relays are going to be for our secondary case functions, such as the lights or defrost. So here you're going to have a common, a normally open, and a normally closed terminal for each relay. And then just like with the sensors being somewhat flexible, the polarity of each of these relays is also flexible, where it can be set through the programming to define whether a normally open or normally closed load is being controlled. One thing I'll point out here is that the relays are not internally fused. So if you are wiring a load in, you'll want to make sure you're either adding an external fuse or an interposing relay into the circuit, and essentially treating our relay on our end just like a control signal to that cube relay that you may be using or external fusing. That way, if there's any damage to the load, it doesn't take out our case controller as well and require that to be replaced. To the left of the case controller, we'll see a series of LEDs here to give us different indications. At the top, once 24 volts has been applied to the case controller, we'll get a green LED to indicate power is okay. Just below that is a communication error LED, where if the 750 no longer is talking to a system manager, it's tied to on a network, we'll get a red indicator light there telling us that there's no more communication. And as we continue to move down the left column here, we'll see that we have a LED indicator for each relay on the case controller. So when we're energizing the relay or putting it to the normally open side of the contact, we'll get a green indicator here telling us that that is taking place, which again, for certain loads, depending on the polarity of this program, that could mean the load is either on or off. To the right, this column of LEDs, these are some lesser used functions here that we get indicators on, but still can be important nonetheless. So one of those being a service tool LED in case someone has a computer tied to the case controller to let them know that that connection is being recognized. And then also an alarm indicator locally, which tells us any general alarms that the 750's generated do exist within the controller and are active. So here you can see a fully wired 750 application. So here we're controlling electronic expansion valves on four separate evaporators. As you can see, there's dedicated set of temperature sensors for each evaporator. So you'll see discharge and return air sensors for inside of the case, coil or evaporator outlet temperature sensor, as well as a defrost termination temp sensor for each. Not all of these are required for every application, but we are showing them here with the electronic expansion valves. In the middle of the case controller, you'll see a single pressure transducer, an AKS-32R. With this controlling just a single case, we don't need multiple transducers as the suction pressure is consistent across all four evaporators. Down along the bottom of the case controller, you can see again to the left are four solid state relays for the expansion valves. And then to the right are secondary case functions. And what I'll point out here is that you can have individual defrost heaters or defrost relays for each section of the 750. This will allow you to individually terminate each coil as it hits its defrost temperature. And that is how you wire the power, communication, and I/O to an AK-CC 750.
For more information on this topic, see the description below. And for more videos like this, visit our YouTube channel, Danfoss Cool US, and thank you for watching.